Good morning, students. This is your science teacher. Hope you all are doing well, and this cyclone didn't cause much damage to you, and maintaining proper rules and regulations of lockdown. Today we'll be doing our first chapter because we'll be completing it. Last week we left the basic practices of crop production and management. So that part I wanted to complete in a single day, and that is why this week today we will be completing the whole portion of basic practices. Okay, so let's get started. Now there are various tasks performed by a farmer to produce a good crop, and that is known as basic agricultural practices or basic practices of crop production. So let us see one by one what are the basic practices. First of all, selection of location and nature of the soil is very much important to grow any kind of crop. Secondly, preparation of soil, that is by plowing, by leveling and manuring. These are the process by which soil is prepared so that we get good crop quality and amount also. Next, the selection of seeds, sowing by using a seed drill or by transplantation method of seedlings. This selection of seeds and sowing is very much important. After that, irrigation, a very important part. Then application of manures, fertilizers and light irrigation. After that, we also need to protect our crop from weeds. So weeding by using trowel, harrow or by using any weedicides, which is important. After that, crop production by using pesticide. And last, when we see that our crop has gone through all the above practices, harvesting, threshing and winnowing is important. Lastly, we will store the food grains, and that also need to be checked because storing of food grains is very much important. Now, one by one, we will discuss all of these basic practices. Now, number one is selection of location and nature of soil. For healthy growth, plants need air, sunlight, water and nutrients. And therefore, the most important step in agriculture is the right choice of soil and its location. Now, we will see there are some useful suggestions for it. What are it? The first is the crop field should be open so that sufficient air and sunlight are available to the plants. Okay, class? Next, the field should be fenced from all the sides so that any stray cattle are not able to harm our crop, because if they enter our area of growing crops, it can be harmed or damaged. Then the soil should contain all the nutrients needed by the crop. The soil may be tested for its quality at any soil testing center. So this is the first procedure, that is selection of location and nature of soil. Next, the preparation of soil is important because it involves three steps: plowing, leveling and manuring. What is plowing? Let us see. The process of loosening and turning up the soil is called tilling or plowing. Traditional plows made of wood or iron, they are driven by animals. But nowadays, this plowing is done with tractor-driven cultivator. Okay, and loosening of soil will have some advantage of its own. What are they? Turning and loosening of soil, it will bring the nutrient-rich soil to the top so that the plants can use these nutrients. And then it is also very much easy and good for the penetration of the roots, because if we loosen the soil and we turn up the soil, so what will happen? Easy penetration and deeper penetration is possible. It also provides good aeration of the roots, and it promotes growth of useful soil bacteria, earthworm, etc. These bacteria, they provide nutrient to the soil, so they are important. And after plowing, the next step is leveling. The plowed land is leveled and then it is pressed lightly. Okay, pressed lightly with the help of a wooden plank or iron leveler. So this is the procedure of leveling, and this is done why? To break or crush bigger chunks of dry soil into the smaller pieces, to protect the upper layer of the soil from erosion by wind or water, or to prevent water logging and promote uniform irrigation. So this is the process of leveling. After that, it comes to manuring. Now during manuring, what do we mean by manuring? Manuring, mixing of soil with manure. When it is a substance, basically it is an organic substance which is obtained from the vegetable and animal waste, which are decomposed by microbes. And some common and important manure are, first is farmyard manure. This mainly consists of animal dung, straw and leaves, etc. Next is the green manure, which consists of agricultural waste, commonly from the leguminous crop, which is plowed back into the soil. And after that, compost manure, which is made from the cattle, shade waste and the dry leaves. This is the three type of manure which we use for the preparation of soil. After the preparation of soil, the third procedure is practice is selection of seeds and sowing. After the field is prepared, seeds are selected. Seeds are selected, and while selecting seeds, there are some suggestions which should be kept in mind. First is select only good quality seed and disease resistant, also high yielding seeds, and treat the seeds with a fungicide before sowing. So these two steps are very important. After that, seeds are scattered in the field using any of the two methods. So there are two methods for scattering of the seeds in the field. First is by scattering them in the field by hand, and this method is called broadcasting, which is by using a mechanical broadcaster, as you can see over here. This is mechanical broadcasting. And the second is by using seed drill. So a machine is used over here, and sowing by using seed drill saves time actually and labor. Seeds are placed in the seed bowl, and as the plow moves, it makes furrows in the soil and the seeds are then sown. I have given a picture of seed drill in our previous class, where I have talked about implements and tools. So you can see over there that seed drill picture is given. Okay. Time acha to. Next method is irrigation. Now, the process of supplying water to the crop plants by means of canals, reservoirs, tube wells or drip water system is termed as irrigation. And this thing we have studied in our earlier classes also, or in previous classes of yours. The time and frequency of irrigation, they vary from crop to crop and soil to soil, and also from season to season. Now, what are the sources of irrigation? Water can be obtained from many sources, such as wells and tube wells, ponds, lakes and rivers, dams and canals. Okay, these are the sources of irrigation. And various methods are followed for irrigation. One is the traditional method of irrigation. First, we will talk about the traditional method, which are swinging basket method, moat or simple pulley system, water wheel method, chain pump method. Then there is a Dhekli and Rahat lever system. So there are multiple methods which are very much traditional. And in all these methods, you will see that water is lifted using manpower or animal power. In modern version of these methods, water pumps running on diesel, electricity, biogas or solar energy are used for lifting water. Okay, so I have given you a picture of some traditional methods of irrigation: moat pulley system, chain pump, Dhekli, Rahat or lever system. So these are the traditional method. Now we are going to talk about the modern methods of irrigation. Now modern method of irrigation are of two types, based on economical use of water. They are very much useful in water deficient areas. So they are of two types. First is a sprinkler system. Okay, this system, they consist of a perpendicular pipe. So you can see over here, there are perpendicular multiple pipes which are joined to the main pipeline at regular intervals. And now water in these pipelines, they flow at a high pressure. From this main point, they come up and they flow it at a very high pressure, and then they are getting sprinkled on crops. So this method is very useful in irrigating sandy soil. This is sprinkler system. This is very important class. And next is the drip system, which is also important. In drip system, what happens in this system, water falls drop by drop on the position of the roots, at the position of the roots of each and every plant. And this is the best technique to water plant, as it prevents wastage of water because the root is directly getting water over here. So drip system is also very intelligent and important modern method of irrigation. One more method is there, which is lift irrigation system. Here what happens, you can see in the picture, where the irrigation water is available at a lower level, then that of the land. This land needs to be watered or irrigated. Water irrigation water is made at a lower level, and water is lifted up by pump or by other mechanical devices, and they are conveyed to the agricultural land through channels flowing under gravity. So this is lift irrigation system. And during this irrigation process, one thing that happens is water logging. When too much water is given to the soil, what happens? It becomes wet and water accumulates around the plant. So this is called excessive irrigation or water logging. Now excessive irrigation is harmful to the crop, and that is why we are talking about it. And what happens is excess water and wet soil, they do not permit proper aeration of the seed or the root of the plant. And also water logging increases the amount of salts in the soil, and they damages the soil fertility. So water logging is harmful. Next, we will see the application of fertilizers and manures. What is a fertilizer? It is a man-made inorganic compound or a mixture of compound which supplies specific nutrients to the soil. There are many examples of fertilizers which farmers use, and also many people at home are using diammonium. So as I was saying, that fertilizer is a man-made inorganic compound or a mixture of compounds. It supplies specific nutrients to the soil, and the examples are diammonium phosphate, which provides nitrogen and phosphorus, NPK fertilizer, which provides nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. Then there is urea, which provides nitrogen, superphosphate of lime, calcium and phosphate is provided by this fertilizer. Then there is superphosphate of lime, which provides calcium and phosphate, there are also some advantages of fertilizer, which is each fertilizer provides specific nutrients to the soil. Not that diammonium phosphate will provide calcium. Diammonium phosphate will only provide us with nitrogen and phosphorus. So each fertilizer is having specific nutrient to the soil, and they are crop specific. They are concentrated source of soil nutrients. We need to mix them with something, water or any other product, and then we need to apply it in our crops. They can be easily stored and handled, and they are soluble in water and easily absorbed by the plant. So this was how and why fertilizers are used. Also, given a difference between fertilizers and manures, where it is said that a fertilizer is an inorganic substance that is prepared in the factories, whereas a manure is a mixture of inorganic and organic substances both, and which is obtained by the decomposition of cattle dung, human waste and plant residues. Also, you see, fertilizer provides a specific nutrient to the soil, whereas a manure provides more than one nutrient to the soil. Again, a fertilizer has a high concentration of plant nutrients, okay? But the manure has very low concentration of soil nutrients, right? Now, the next practice of ours is protection from weeds and weeding. Now, what are weeds? They are basically the undesirable plants which grow along with the main crop. Like you must have seen amaranthus, wild oats, chenopodium, these plants growing with our main crop. And the process of removing these weeds from a crop field, that is known as weeding. And this can be done by many ways, that is removing weeds manually, removing weeds using trowel or a harrow, that is a khurpa or harrow, by spraying weedicides over the crop. You must have this question in your mind, that what is weedicide? The weedicide is a chemical substance which destroys weed, but they do not harm our crop, the main crop. And the examples are 2,4-D, diphenoxyacetic acid, MCPA and butachlor. These are the weedicides, important weedicides which farmers and other people use. Next is the protection of our crops from birds, animals and diseases, which can be commonly done. Like protection from stray animals, protection from birds, protection from various diseases, because plants have fungal disease and bacterial diseases. Example, so rust and smut are the fungal diseases of wheat. Okay, in a wheat plant it occurs, and in wilt is a disease which is caused by a bacteria. So protection is required for these plants, and it can be achieved by sowing disease resistant variety of seeds or treating the seeds with fungicides before sowing. Also, protection from pest, which is important. What are pests? Pests are the organisms which damage the crop or make it unfit for human consumption. Rodents, birds, insects, they are the pest. And the crops, they can be protected from pest by killing them. Pesticides kill pest but do not harm the crop plants. The chemicals which can kill only insect, they are the insecticides. And some of the common examples of insecticides are BHC, that is Gamaxine, Malathion, Dimecron and Polythion. These are the examples of insecticide. Okay, so you understood the difference between the weedicides and the insecticide. Okay. Next we'll talk about harvesting and threshing. Now our plant, our crop has grown, we have provided it with water, with manure and fertilizer, and weeding has been done, insecticides has been sprayed. Now harvesting and threshing is required. So harvesting is basically the cutting and gathering of a manured crop. Okay, so harvesting is either done manually with a sickle or with a machine, which is known as combined harvester. After harvesting, threshing is done because the grains are separated from the harvested crop. So threshing is done. It is also done either manually by striking the harvested crop against a hard surface or by using a machine called thresher. And at last, after the grains are separated, the grains are separated from the chaff and hay also. That also needs to be done. And this is done with the help of wind. Okay, the grains are taken in any container, and they are just poured from the above. And you will see that whenever the wind blows, the hay and the chaff are separated from the grain. So that method is winnowing. And lastly, we will talk about storage, because storage is very much important. Okay, before the food grains are stored, they are dried in the sun to remove the excess moisture, or they will get rotten. The dried food grains are then stored in a suitable storage. When we talk about the domestic level, that is in our home, we store them in a small container which is made up of tin coated iron or mud clay. But on commercial level, food grains are stored in a gunny bag or in grain silos. I will definitely tell you what are gunny bags or grain silos. But let's see what happens in commercial level after that. They are stacked in a large godown about 60 to 70 centimeter away from the walls and on the wooden platform about 10 to 15 centimeter above the ground. And also pathways for fumigation and inspections are provided so that people can come and visit the place, and fumigation and insecticides are sprayed time to time. And when the quantity of food grains to be stored is very large, that time comes the need of grain silos. Then it is stored in grain silos, which are specially designed tall cylindrical storage structures, and they contain different stocks of food grain at different levels. So these are the grain silos, and we know what are gunny bag. Also, to protect our food from rotting, the perishable food materials, they can be stored safely at low temperature also, which will increase the shelf life of our food material. So low temperature is required because it slows down the growth of the bacteria, yeast and the molds, and inhibits the action of enzymes present in the food material. Also, low temperature helps the food to retain their nutritive value. And at home, what we do? At home, food materials are stored in an ice box or in a refrigerator, right? But on commercial level, what we do? The perishable food materials are stored in either deep freezers or cold storages. Okay, big storages, cold storages or deep freezers. And buffer stock of food is very important, is one important thing, because we know some crops are made for some particular season only, but still we see that crop in the market, okay, in different season also. To ensure that the food grains are available throughout the year and at every place in the country, it was planned by the government to build a huge reserve stock of food grains to meet the emergency requirement. And the huge reserve stocks of food grains built by the government by purchasing food grain from the farmer, this is the buffer stock of food grain. Our country has a very favorable buffer stock of food grain, which helps to maintain the price line of the food grains in the open market, because we get each and every type of food material throughout the year. Okay, because of this buffer stock of food. Okay, so class, this was the last portion which was remaining. We have completed basic practices of production. At last, I have given you a small note about the syllabus which we have completed till date. Go through this and do not forget to store all the study materials properly in a file or a folder in your phone or computer or laptop. And if you have any problem or any chapter is missing or explanation is missing, you can definitely pin me or message me and tell me whatever thing is required. And if any query is there, you can also ask me over there. Okay. the question answers of this chapter I have provided you. Remaining question answers we'll be doing in our next class. Hope you were able to understand. Thank you.